Thumbs up. Okay. Great. So Cathy Goldstein, thank you for having me. We're going to talk about sleep tracking in the wild, and you will hear me refer to these devices as consumer sleep technologies or CSTs. That's just what our field calls them, but just so you're aware, you'll hear me say that over and over again. Here are my potential conflicts of interest. And here is our roadmap for today. And we're going to start by talking about why do we even want to track sleep? So we have this paradox in our field where we know that sleep deprivation, sleep disorders, poorly timed sleep cause problems not due to a single exposure, but due to chronic exposure to the disturbance in sleep quality or duration every night. But what is our gold standard measure of sleep? It's what we call a polysomnogram, which requires somebody to come to the sleep lab, and then they are all hooked up to a variety of parameters. So EEG leads to monitor brain waves. We monitor breathing both qualitatively and quantitatively at the mouth and nose. Oxygen on the finger. We monitor EMG near the eyes, chin, and legs. We monitor respiratory effort around the chest and abdomen, and we monitor EKG. So as you can imagine, this not only requires a sleep lab, but it also requires a skilled staff. And this is great to diagnose obstructive sleep apnea and a few other things, and to also determine what CPAP settings treat somebody's obstructive sleep apnea. However, as you can imagine, this is completely impractical beyond 1 to 2 nights. So what is our currently accepted method of objectively recording sleep in a longitudinal fashion? It's something called actigraphy. And when I refer to actigraphy, I'm talking about FDA cleared, they're class 2 medical devices, wrist-worn accelerometers. So the older ones used to have a solid state piezoelectric accelerometer. So you would move it around and there was a seismic mass attached to a crystal. And in response to movement, the mass would compress that crystal and a voltage was generated. And then activity counts were derived from that. And then the newer actigraphs have a microelectromechanical system or MEMS accelerometer. And the rationale for using actigraphy to estimate sleep is that we move more when we're awake than we do when we're asleep. So we give the patients these devices, and the acceleration data is then digitized in activity counts. That data is then downloaded from the device, and then a software package applies an equation to estimate sleep by categorizing which epochs are sleep and which epochs are wake, and that's typically through some sort of weighted sum. And the reason that sleep researchers and sleep clinicians were really comfortable with actigraphy is not only that it was FDA cleared, but its output was compared to polysomnogram, our gold standard, in many peer-reviewed publications. So we felt that we had a good understanding of its performance. And the actigraph that is on that slide there, that's the Respironics ActiWatch, and that was the main one that everyone used. And that arm of the company is just recently announced that it's no longer going to exist. So this won't be an option anymore. Now, we know from a systematic review of actigraphy that these devices do indeed provide distinct data that is useful for the evaluation and management of certain sleep disorders, including insomnia, circadian rhythm sleep-wake disorders, disorders of hypersomnolence, and insufficient sleep syndrome. And the data that an actigraph provides is actually preferred over self-report for these conditions. Now, we also know, unless you live in a hole, that sleep duration, typically not getting enough sleep, has been associated with virtually every health condition. So sleep has become a really interesting predictor across a variety of health states and continues to be examined in research. And also, objective sleep measures have been found to be beneficial over self-report for research purposes, primarily due to the fact that sleep duration from self-report is not always accurate, and the direction and magnitude of those inaccuracies can vary based on things like demographics, the presence or absence of other sleep conditions, when you ask the question about sleep duration, and how you ask the question about sleep duration. So for both clinical and research purposes, objective sleep tracking is preferred over subjective self-report. Now, we've always conceptualize sleep and its contribution to other health conditions as sleep duration. However, sleep duration is not the only metric of sleep health. So there's been a multidimensional definition of sleep that's been proposed with seven domains. So duration, continuity, timing, sleepiness, alertness, quality, rhythmicity, and regularity. And the metrics that have ACT in the parentheses, those metrics are acquired objectively and longitudinally through actigraphic recording. There's also a composite score where you add up the number of those domains that are in extreme values. So why is this an important definition of sleep health? Well, it's thought to be very powerful. So for example, in a study of sleep's contribution to mortality, all seven domains and that composite score considered simultaneously were found to be third in predicting mortality. And you can see, so it's circled there, it's right behind cognition and cardiovascular disease. Sleep duration alone is all the way back here. Another way to conceptualize sleep health, apart from sleep duration, is something called intra-individual variability, and that's the variation of sleep parameters around the mean, right? Because by recording sleep over days, you can get means of your sleep parameters, and then by measuring the variability around that mean, you get the IIV. And this has been found an important contributor to psychiatric, metabolic, and cardiovascular outcomes. And I just want to show you here, this is from the Journal of the American College of Cardiology. So in this top picture here, so this is one participant from the study who was wearing an actigraph. And on the y-axis, we have days of the week here. And then on the x-axis, we have time, 8 p.m. to 8 a.m. the next day. And we can see that this individual has both very regular sleep duration night to night and very regular timing of their sleep night to night. You can see the standard deviation of sleep duration is 10 minutes and the standard deviation of sleep onset timing is 9 minutes. Just, I'm sure everyone's sleep who's listening right now is like that. I don't even think mine is like that. Now on the bottom panel here, we can see we have a very irregular sleeper. So the duration varies night to night with a standard deviation of 144 minutes of sleep duration. And sleep onset timing is also very variable with a standard deviation of about 2 hours. Now, when they followed these individuals who they recorded sleep with and calculated that IIV and determined if they had a cardiovascular event, the hazard for cardiovascular disease increased with a dose response and was markedly more in individuals who had standard deviation of 120 minutes in sleep duration and then greater than 90 minutes in sleep onset timing standard deviation had almost double the risk of cardiovascular disease. So to capture things like intra-individual variability and that multidimensional sleep definition, we need objective longitudinal tracking. You can't get people write this down and track their sleep. This needs to be passively recorded to get these metrics. So I said we have these actigraphs. So what's wrong with using that? So these are very expensive. They're about $800 a device. So it's going to be difficult to use them for large studies. The data acquisition and storing methods are really old. So they have to be initialized in person and then downloaded. So that requires at least two contacts with a trained member of the research team. And it's not going to be very amenable for remote data collection. It's resource intensive. So after this data is acquired, there's a cleaning process and it has to be interpreted. So that's going to be very burdensome for the research team. And it's very sensitive, but it's not specific for sleep. So what does that mean? So that means that the algorithm applied to the data collected by the watch, it's not going to miss any periods of sleep, but it's oftentimes going to misclassify non-moving wakefulness as sleep. So what happens as individuals have increased wake during the sleep period, or what we call WASO, as they have increased arousals from sleep and reduced sleep efficiency, these metrics are not going to be as good. So we see less accurate sleep parameters from actigraphy when our study participants actually have a sleep disorder or they're sleeping during the day like a shift worker. These devices are owned by the health system and research team, not the individual. So they typically need to go back to the research team. And so the duration of reporting for research typically cannot be very long, and the cohort size is limited as well. So actigraphs have a lot of limitations. Those, as well as the fact that the main one we used is essentially discontinued. So despite the strong wording that we have in our diagnostic manual that this should be the way we monitor sleep in a variety of sleep conditions, what happens when we start getting real, the real world sleep medicine and research? We go back to that subjective sleep report and ask, how much do you sleep each night? And at face value, this is a simple question, but you can think about all the different interpretations of this, people averaging this over the course of a week, or maybe averaging it over the course of a month. Is this just on weeknights? Is it weeknights and weekends? Do I need to include my naps? Do I do some calculation between my bedtime and my wake time? This is very hard for somebody to estimate. So we can look longitudinally and have somebody self-report on a sleep diary every day. And that's a little better than the cross-sectional question of how much do you sleep? But these are often incomplete. They're very burdensome for the patients. They could be inaccurate as well. And then we have certain populations that obviously can't comply with this. So say we can use actigraphy. Even when we do use actigraphy, we're limited in the scale and the scope of the research. So we talk about it being objective longitudinal recording, but it's truly micro-longitudinal. So if you look at that intra-individual variability study that looked at sleep parameters that were predictive of cardiovascular disease, they recorded for 7 days. And in the study looking at mortality, 5 days of sleep data were recorded. So if we think about sleep and chronic disease, I would expect that we would learn a lot more if weeks, months, seasons, and even years of sleep recording was performed. So what are our options when we look at these consumer available devices that are just ubiquitous and all over the place? So they fall into two main categories: wearables, so worn on the wrist, worn on the ring, headbands, and then nearables, which are devices in the environment that track sleep but don't actually touch the patient. And those can be by the bed, under the mattress, and there may even be others. So the wrist and ring worn devices, they contain a MEMS accelerometer for the motion sensor. And then they also contain photoplethysmography, which we'll talk a little bit about in more detail in a few slides here. And photoplethysmography is how we get pulse rate, but can also monitor blood oxygen saturation from these devices. Less commonly, you'll see a temperature sensor, skin conductance, and some devices even have an efferent output. So for example, there's something called a thin ring, and it gives a vibratory output for something called intensive sleep retraining. And then some devices have a low oximetry reading alert, like the Wellu ring. The headbands contain a dry EEG sensor, so you're actually getting sleep as defined by brainwave activity, but also sometimes have an accelerometer and PPG to add another input to their algorithms. And these almost always have some kind of efferent limb, typically by augmentation of slow waves from an acoustic stimuli. The non-contact bedside use ultra low power radio frequency waves to monitor movement and model sleep from that. These are particularly unique because they also provide information about the sleep environment like light, noise, and temperature. And then there's also under the mattress or devices that are embedded within the mattress for a smart bed. And these use something called ballistocardiography, which is the visual representation of body movement that's due to the heart expelling blood into the great arteries, which generates quite a bit of movement. And then that's graphed and things can be modeled from it, like heart rate, respiratory indices, and sleep stages. And the ballistocardiography technology is actually really, really old. As you can see from this very old paper here that discusses static charge beds, there were two metal plates under the mattress to measure ballistocardiography. And this was from a 1981 paper. I'm just gonna read this. And this is the commentary on polysomnogram from the authors. For many patients, it is difficult even to sleep in these strange circumstances, and at least the normality of sleep is often doubtful. The experiment is very expensive and troublesome, and thus sleep studies have not come into common clinical use. So even 40 years ago, they were trying to find an alternative, objective way to measure sleep, and we're still working on that. Okay, so how do these devices work? So how do you get from sensor to sleep? My patients like to tell me, my watch says I get no REM sleep. And I say, watch doesn't say anything about your sleep. Your watch records motion and heart rate and math tells you about your sleep. So the watches we talk about typically contain a triaxial accelerometer. And so you can see motion. This is actually raw motion, what it looks like from an Apple Watch in the three different axes. And then photoplethysmography is going to give you your pulse signal. And then these data streams are and also quantified values from them are analyzed by an algorithm. I have the algorithm in a black box because it typically is a machine learning algorithm. There's obviously IP surrounding these, so we don't know what they are, but most of them are thought to use machine learning. And then this algorithm classifies not only sleep versus wake, but also sleep stages, light, deep, and REM. And then this is presented back to the user or the investigator in a more meaningful way that what we're used to looking at, which is called a hypnogram. Now, photoplethysmography works in a really interesting way. So the wrist-worn and ring-worn photoplethysmographers have the light source and the photo detector on the same plane. And the way these work is because blood absorbs light. And so right after systole, the blood volume in our peripheral blood vessels goes up. And so more light is absorbed, decreased light is reflected to that photo detector, and changes in that are then analyzed to quantify pulse rate and then something called pulse rate variability. And so these are proxies for heart rate and heart rate variability, and they are very comparable to when you compare them to EKG in the same individual. And the reason that we need heart rate and heart rate variability is because these, along with the heart rate variability frequency domains, have these very characteristic patterns during different sleep stages. And this is what allows you not just to categorize sleep versus wake, but to get REM and light non-REM and deep non-REM sleep from these devices. Now, PPG has also been opened up in these devices to measure oximetry. So what we're used to with photoplethysmography is a medical oximeter, right? So on the finger, so that's a transmissive photoplethysmographer where the light source is across the capillary bed from the photo detector. But like we talked about with the CST, as you can see in the picture here, it's in the same plane on the wrist where the LED light provides the light and then it's reflected back to the photo detector to calculate those changes. And with medical PPG, it's the red infrared wavelength difference that allows the calculation of SpO2 oximetry. But in the CST, you're typically comparing two wavelengths of green light to estimate oximetry signal, though there are some that use a red light in addition. Okay, so how can these devices be used? So the obvious use case is to use these as a stand-in for actigraphy. So clinically, those indications are when we're looking at somebody that we think has narcolepsy or a similar disorder, we're going to study them in our sleep lab with an overnight polysomnogram and then keep the leads on them the next day for a nap test called an MSLT. The MSLT is highly sensitive to sleep deprivation, so we use actigraphy in the 7 days leading up to the in-lab testing to determine their sleep duration, and that's something that consumer sleep technologies might be used for. There's also another condition called idiopathic hypersomnia, where individuals oftentimes sleep more than 660 minutes in a 24-hour day. So that's another indication to identify chronic recurrent sleep deprivation and insufficient sleep syndrome, to evaluate sleep-wake timing and circadian rhythm sleep-wake disorders, and in insomnia. So these sleep conditions also for research purposes could be considered as use cases for consumer sleep technologies in the place of actigraphy. However, there's a lot of characteristics of the consumer sleep technologies that are distinct from actigraphs. So these are very widespread. People that have no sleep issue, that aren't in a research protocol, all kinds of people are wearing these devices. They're much less expensive. Many times people want to own one of these. So they don't just want to wear it for a sleep study or a research study. They want to own this device. They use them for extensive periods of time, oftentimes for years. The data transmission is wireless and it can be in near real time. And these devices integrate with other apps and health technologies. So all of these characteristics make this a more powerful tool than just subbing in for that actigraphic sleep duration that we see in so many studies. So one of the ways these can be used in research, I'm just going to provide a few different use cases here, is positive airway pressure effectiveness. So why is this important? So the most common sleep disorder in the world is obstructive sleep apnea. It's what we take care of in about 90% of our clinic patients. And it is very, very important for a variety of different health conditions, everything from cardiovascular, metabolic disease, mortality, dementia, and psychiatric disorders. So we treat obstructive sleep apnea with CPAP. And what's very helpful from both a research and clinical standpoint is when people are using a CPAP machine, you can measure how long they're using it each night from the data from the machine. And we can also measure an estimate of their apnea hypopnea index for the severity of their sleep apnea. However, one of the big problems is we don't know what patients with obstructive sleep apnea's sleep looks like when they are off of the CPAP machine. So consumer sleep technologies have now been able not just to estimate sleep stages, but the data has also been modeled to predict apneas and hypopneas to give you that apnea hypopnea index, which is a severity marker of obstructive sleep apnea. We can see that's been done with near moles, both an under the mattress and non-contact bedside device. And those have performed with pretty good sensitivity and specificity for classifying obstructive sleep apnea at this moderate degree of severity cutoff. But also the wrist-worn wearables have been used. Heart rate variability, respiratory activity, movement, and sleep stage probability from a wrist-worn sensor was put into a deep learning model to predict AHI categories. And you can see for that receiver operating characteristic curve, it did kind of okay in classifying no, mild, moderate, and severe obstructive sleep apnea. Those have been used without oximetry, which is obviously going to be a very important input when we're looking at obstructive sleep apnea, which might improve the performance of these assessment algorithms for sleep disordered breathing. However, there's a lot of concern that we cannot trust the oximeter that's included in consumer smartwatches, and we'll talk about why in a moment here. So why is that important that these devices can record both sleep and sleep apnea? Because then we can record the sleep and apnea hypopnea index burden both on and off therapy, which gives us a better understanding of the actual benefits of CPAP. The reason this is so important is there have been a number of randomized controlled trials that did not show a benefit with CPAP. And that's had policy ramifications, as you can see from the AHQR. They said that randomized controlled trials do not demonstrate that CPAP has a benefit on mortality, cardiovascular outcomes, clinically important changes in psychosocial measures, or any other outcomes. And that has really important ramifications for our patient population, because statements like that could negate insurance coverages. So we need to have a better understanding of how CPAP treats sleep apnea. And the only way to do that in the long term is to have longitudinal monitoring of sleep, both on and off therapy. What about integration with digital health information? So it's great that these devices can estimate sleep, that they can estimate sleep apnea, but the beautiful thing about them is the data that they collect does not occur in a silo. So consumer sleep technologies are also going to record information about arrhythmias, about exercise and recovery. People that wear these are also likely to be amenable to other smart devices for a study. So scales, blood pressure cuffs, glucometers, and all of these through APIs, you're going to be collecting various objective physiological measures alongside each other. What about self-report? So we need objective measures, but self-report is also incredibly important. And we can use apps alongside our sleep tracking wearable app that record caloric intake, alcohol consumption, menstrual cycles, mood, an investigator's own designed app. And something that's really, really important in the sleep world is ecological momentary assessment, because we know we have changes in our sleep and alertness across the 24-hour period. So monitoring our outcomes that we care about, like mood, pain, for example, instantaneously, as opposed to a retroactive questionnaire, are really important. And that's what ecological momentary assessment does. And that can be delivered also through an app alongside what you're using for your wearable sleep tracker. Also, all of our phones that we're deploying these apps on are passively recording data about our geolocation, screen time usage, social media uses, spending, text errors. So we're going to get this digital footprint of not just sleep, activity, heart rate, but also other objective parameters, passively recorded things, and self-report. And that's what's really going to tell us about the contribution of sleep to health, disease, wellness, and behavior, and the interaction of these things. And the endocrinology field has done this. So they have a device agnostic platform that takes in data from fingerstick glucometers, continuous glucose monitors, and wearables. So you can kind of see what that looks like here. You have a glucose, you have activity from a wearable, and you have self-input nutrition. And this also can record insulin if somebody's using an insulin pump. And then all that data can be appreciated together for research or clinical purposes. Now, intervention is one of the most important and powerful parts of using a consumer sleep technology, either clinically or for research purposes. And that's because those interventions can be personalized. They can actually use the patient's own sleep data as opposed to an estimate of what we think their sleep is. They're dynamic. We can change the intervention based on the patient's changing sleep as opposed to what we think they're sleeping. And the interventions can be deployed in near real time. Moving to circadian rhythms. So we've talked primarily about sleep, but circadian rhythms have been found to be a very important marker of health, and disruption in circadian rhythms is involved with the same host of disease states that we talked about for sleep loss, everything from cognitive disorders, cardiovascular, metabolic, immune, GI, have all been found to be negatively impacted by circadian disruption. And the problem with circadian rhythm research, as a lot of people in this group can tell you, is that the gold standard marker of circadian rhythms is something called dim light melatonin onset. And that is very, very difficult to measure. So it requires people coming into a specialized lab, typically for a saliva sample that starts many, many hours prior to their usual bedtime. And it also has to take place in dim light. That's why it's called dim light melatonin onset, because light suppresses our melatonin secretion. So can devices be used to estimate circadian phase, to estimate our internal timing system? This has been previously done with actigraphy. So a cosine curve with a period of around 24 hours can be fit to activity and rest data to determine some metrics of circadian phase. So time of circadian phase, time to peak activity, circadian period, which is the time it takes to complete one circadian cycle, amplitude and mean. And then there's something called a pseudo F statistic, which is how well an individual's rest activity conforms to the extended cosine model, so the strength of their circadian rhythm. And this has been found to be a really important predictor of health consequences, including mortality. But we talked about all those limitations of actigraphy. So for example, that people aren't typically wearing an actigraph in a study for more than a week or so. So if we had a consumer sleep technology to record data, we could monitor circadian phase and other metrics around the circadian rhythm over a much longer time period. And additionally, there's other models that can be used to model circadian phase. So to talk about a study that we did here at University of Michigan, our mathematical collaborators used a limit cycle oscillator model, which is a differential equation that takes into account mathematical properties of both the central clock, but also the light input to the clock, which is the major entraining factor to our circadian rhythm, and then models that to predict circadian phase. And so what we did is we bought some off-the-shelf wearable devices that we could access the actual raw motion from. They were actually Apple Watches, and we had subjects wear those for 7 to 10 days, I believe. And then they came in to the circadian rhythm laboratory for a dim light melatonin onset. And the limit cycle oscillator model was able to predict their circadian phase with a mean error of about an hour. So these devices can potentially use to estimate circadian phase, and we haven't previously been able to measure that in the ambulatory setting. This can also be applied to heart rate recorded from the consumer sleep technology with PPG to model circadian rhythm in a different way. Okay, one of the most exciting things that these devices can do is they can really increase the scope and scale of our research. So Fitbits were used in a study to measure sleep across different age groups, and it showed some things that were expected. So with increasing age, sleep duration decreased, awakenings increased, sleep timing got earlier with age, nighttime awakenings increased in women during early and middle adulthood, but not in men. What does that align with? The childbearing and rearing years. Sleep onset and duration variability was fixed across the lifespan, which is something we would expect because people's circadian preference is likely genetically gated, but the sleep offset variability decreased through early adulthood in alignment with what kind of going into the workforce and having children that require you to have a more stable wake time. So these are not things that were very surprising, but what was amazing about this study is it recorded over 11 million nights of data over nearly 70,000 adults in 47 countries. And that would not be possible if these were with use of actigraphs. The Fitbit, use of the Fitbit device here really is what allowed that to happen. There's a study by the PI is Dr. Sen that you guys are probably all well aware of, the intern health study, which uses Fitbits to monitor activity and sleep in first year training physicians. And in this paper where we were looking at their sleep variability and mood, sleep was recorded for 115 days in this IHS cohort, more than 2,000 of them. And if you know anything about intern year, this is an incredibly stressful time. And if these individuals were coming in for actigraph downloads, paper and pencil questionnaire, this wouldn't have been possible. So the use of a consumer sleep technology here really benefited this and allowed for sleep recording over such a long time during such a stressful period. Okay, so if these devices are so great, there must be some downfalls. And the biggest concern about using these devices in research is what is the accuracy? Can they really estimate sleep from wake? And this used to be just such a barrier, but we have more and more data now to show that these off-the-shelf devices can work pretty well. So in the table on the right, you see an epic by epic agreement of 7 different devices. These are both wearables and nearables, and also that FDA cleared ActiveWatch. I just want to tell you what an epic by epic study is for these validation studies. So that's when somebody is simultaneously wearing or using one of these consumer sleep technologies, or a cohort of people is. And what you do is you look at simultaneous 30-second periods. So your ground truth here is scored polysomnogram that's been scored by a technician, and that 30-second period is labeled as wake, non-REM 1, 2, 3, or stage REM sleep. And then the device is going to output either wake, light sleep, or deep sleep. If the device says, okay, this is sleep, and the ground truth is sleep, we consider that a true positive. If the device says this is wake when it's actually sleep, we consider that a false negative, because your state of interest here is sleep. So what you get is sensitivity, which is the proportion of true sleep epochs that were correctly identified by the device algorithm. Specificity is the proportion of true wake epochs that are correctly identified by the device algorithm. And you can see with FDA cleared actigraphy, the sensitivity is very high, 97%, and the specificity, like we said, is low, 39%, because of that misclassification of non-moving wakefulness as sleep. So when we look at the Fitbit, we can see this is a Fitbit Alta here. We see a sensitivity of 95%, specificity of 54%, so likely better than actigraphy. And then we see that the Garmin performed really poorly with really low specificities here. And then these are nearable devices. This picture here is from a recent review that looked at validation studies. So again, these studies that compare these consumer sleep technologies to our gold standard ground truth of scored polysomnogram. And what you can see, I just want to call these out because these might be devices you're interested in using. We have Oura Ring here with sensitivity of around 96% and specificity in the 40s. We have Apple Watch with an investigator developed but proprietary algorithm, has a sensitivity for sleep and a specificity of 60% for wakefulness. This is our Apple Watch study where we looked, where we made an algorithm to classify sleep versus wake. And we actually, that algorithm is open source. You can get it on GitHub. And the sensitivity of our sleep-wake classifier was 93%. Specificity was 60%. This is the Fitbit Alta, Fitbit Surge, Fitbit Charge, another model of Fitbit Charge. And then this is the first study to compare a Fitbit to polysomnogram back in 2012. And you can see that the specificity there was low with that model. So we're seeing that, like actigraphy, the sensitivity for sleep is high, the specificity for wakefulness is lower, but overall, these devices appear to perform better than historically quoted metrics for actigraphy. The sleep staging, whether these devices can categorize light sleep, deep sleep, stage REM sleep, has been all over the place. You can see there's kind of wide ranges there, but you'll notice if you look at the literature over time, they get better and better as the algorithms improve. Here's our nearables. So the sensitivity is a little bit decreased as compared to the wearables, but the specificity is better. That's likely because these might be better metrics of movement when the patient is laying in bed, because you're getting a whole body representation. So it's picking up, it's more sensitive for movement, and it's doing better knowing what is kind of minimally moving wakefulness versus true sleep, as you can see from there. Okay, so those studies that determined how these devices perform, we call them validation studies, where we compare a wearable consumer sleep technology or nearable consumer sleep technology to our gold standard PSG. And they're done in a very specific way. So the polysomnogram is scored manually by technicians, and that's considered our ground truth. They're often in specific populations, either healthy individuals or a convenient sample is used of people going to the sleep lab, which means they're probably expected to have obstructive sleep apnea. The study coordinator puts the device on the patient. We don't let the patient put it on themselves, and we enforce the time in bed. We know when these people are trying to sleep because we turn the lights out at a certain time, we turn the lights on at a certain time, and we look at the performance of the device and algorithm in between those time points. The study coordinator also synchronizes the device with the app. We don't let the participants do that themselves. These studies are typically only a single night of data, and they record only nighttime sleep. So why am I telling you this? Why do you care? Because this has significant ramifications for how performance translates to the real world in your study. And those can be due to how we conceptualize sleep. They can be localized to the device and algorithm. They can be patient specific. They could be related to the context and environment. So for example, the patient is putting the device on their body or in the sleep environment. The patient might be sleeping outside of the main sleep bout, which is going to be a problem for both wearables and definitely a problem for nearables. And there might be pets or other people in the bed. And so these are really going to change how these translate to the real world. And to dig into some of the others, our definition of ground truth is really problematic. So we know that interscore reliability between technicians scoring a PSG is not perfect. So when these devices are being assessed for their performance, how many technicians should be scoring that PSG? One probably isn't enough. And this is where automated scoring might be beneficial in our future. But at this time, validation studies are recommended to have manually scored data. Now, an in-lab study is going to allow for better data quality also, but the patient's in the sleep lab and they're not sleeping well. And so out-of-center testing might be more translatable to the true in-the-field environment. Now, when we think about these devices, let's think about we have something worn on the wrist that's collecting motion and heart rate data. That data is then being automatically analyzed by an algorithm as compared to somebody having their sleep stages primarily based on an EEG recording, and that classification of sleep stages takes place manually by a person. So these are totally different metrics and a completely different analysis. So consumer sleep technology recorded sleep over time might be a completely different construct than polysomnogram recorded sleep. But we really don't, we accept that for sleep logs, but we don't accept that for actigraphy and consumer sleep technologies. We hold them to this completely unattainable standard of a PSG, which measures an entirely different thing. Also, these devices give you metrics that we don't even know what they are. So sleep, 60, pay attention, sleep performance, 100%. We don't have a gold standard comparator that tells us what these mean. So that can also be a problem. And we recommend people obviously don't use those metrics in their research. The time in bed detection is something that people don't talk about, which is a big problem. So when we say, when the Fitbit's like, oh, look how accurate our sleep staging is, this is great for research. That was based on a validation study where the lights were turned out, and that was the start of the night of sleep. And then the lights were turned on, marking the end of the night of sleep, as you can see from those arrows there. But that's not how we use these devices in the home. We use these devices passively. So the real world utility of that consumer sleep technology is not just based on how well that sleep classifier performs in the sleep lab, that sensitivity and specificity that I cited, but also if it's being deployed in the correct window. And that's something that is rarely ever studied in those validation studies and could significantly impact the accuracy of the wearable in your population. So I always recommend using a sleep log along with these devices, because that is going to help you understand the time in bed window, particularly when you have some outliers in your data. Population is very important. BMI and skin color impact the performance of these sensors. These validation studies, if one is done in peds, the accuracy is in a pediatric population. It might change in older adults, adolescents. We find these devices perform differently in regards to accuracy if you actually have a sleep disorder. And because of the reliance on pulse rate variability in staging sleep, we don't have a good understanding if these work in populations with cardiac arrhythmias, other forms of heart disease, or on medications that impact heart rate variability. What about spinal cord injury, stroke patients, and those in the ICU? These devices monitor motion as part of their algorithm, and they may not perform as well in those groups, and it remains unclear. When you look at the oximetry, which is becoming more and more used in these devices, think about an FDA-cleared pulse oximeter. So kind of the best version of this, if that reads 90%, the true blood oxygen might be between 86 and 94%. So there's a lot of variability there. And then when we move towards a consumer sleep technology, PPG, to measure oximetry, we have even more room for error. So the device is reflective, not transmissive. So we don't have that vascular bed between the photodetector and the light source. We have it both on top. The green light is going to have less accuracy in individuals with darker skin and those who are obese. And then we're putting it in a different location. So like I said, there's less vascular density, but there's also more hair. There's more motion when you think about the watch moving on the wrist, and there's decreased contact as compared to a medical grade pulse oximeter. So these have the potential to be very inaccurate. And I don't think we're there yet in using these as a research or clinical tool. This also causes problems when we look at bias. So because photoplethysmography is a main input to the sleep staging algorithms, we know that the oximetry can be wrong, but also the sleep-wake predictions can be incorrect because that green wavelength light is influenced by skin pigmentation. And so we're looking at direct measurements that might be inaccurate, but also the values derived from that. And also the interventions that are developed from those might be inaccurate in certain groups. And then this is scalable and likely to increase bias in medicine or research. Another very important thing to keep in mind that we don't know how quite to deal with yet is when we have performance cited for these devices, it's cited for these devices. That means when you get a paper on a Fitbit Charge 2's performance, that really is only specific to a Fitbit Charge 2. And not only that, but even within that model, the sensors could change. If there's a cheaper sensor from another factory that comes about, that might be changed, and that could influence the accuracy in your study. The big thing is that the firmware of the device and the software algorithms are continuously updated. So people like to say, oh, they were updated with Respironics Actaware too, but they made investigators aware of those. So these are automatically updated, and that can change the performance of your device in the middle of your study. Because these use machine learning, there's also the issue of locked versus adaptive algorithms. Even independent of a software change, these algorithms are learning all the time. And the FDA still doesn't even know how to regulate these for clinical or research use. Other problems include implementation. So just like this is, we have to think of ways of how we would implement this with our electronic health record. In research, we need standalone device agnostic platforms for data acquisition and viewing. There are quite a few of these, but you'd have to know how to use them. We don't have standardized data models in regards to what metrics we're quantifying from the recorded data in regards to sleep. We need data pipelines that are accessible to investigators to transfer data from that device agnostic platform to Michigan servers, and data security is always an issue. We don't understand some of the relevant outcomes from these devices because they're recording sleep in a different way. So we don't know if recording sleep with these devices actually is going to reduce time to sleep disorder diagnosis or improve treatment, improve symptoms, is going to be cost effectiveness. And then there's also the unintended consequence that sleep providers would overly rely on the metrics from these. And like we talked about before, there's legal and ethical concerns related to the disparities that these devices could potentially augment. Nonetheless, I do think that this is an improvement from where we are now, where sleep medicine and research really puts the investigator and the institution in the center, and we're using these outdated devices and paper and pencil sleep logs, and we can move to a situation where our patient is really in the center of our research and our care, because we're providing patient-generated data as an input to their healthcare. We're designing interventions that are dynamic and personalized, and we can scale research and do it in the long term. And I see Victoria's unmuting her video, so I'm right at time here. So if you have any questions, I can take a few now, but you can email me as well.